Hello, everybody. It is 10:01 p.m. Central Time on Saturday, November 5th, 2016, and it's Sunday overseas, so hope you guys all had a good weekend or are having a good Saturday night. Welcome in here to the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we daily recap the events that strike around the planet, and we also issue earthquake forecasts. We keep track of the areas which are struck versus the areas which are missed. And, guys, that leads us right into the earthquake activity that struck today. Everybody here in chat, welcome in. If you're new here, please subscribe up. We try to grow the channel on a daily basis. And, of course, you know how it goes on YouTube. Got to get those subscribers, right? So, that being said, let's get into it, guys. Take a look at it. A swarm has carried on in Europe today. Now, we went and looked these up earlier, and I'm going to do that for you now so we can get a better idea what's going on. But the earthquake list topped out today at 4.0 to 4.3. And many of these were downgraded by the INGV, one being downgraded, I think, to 3.5, 3.6. That started out more like in the 4 range, 4.1 to 4.3. Point two. Now, we told you last night there was a 4.3 over to the east a day ago, which you can see marked on the screen here now, and that was down in Albania, just north northwest of Greece, south of Bosnia. Or, I'm sorry, Albania, where the 4.3 is. Then Algeria was struck by a 4.2. Additionally, apparently Egypt was struck this morning, but we didn't have any reports to show you here on the screen. I don't have a feed to show that to you. You guys are welcome to do the research on that. And there's some debate on the magnitude as well, whether or not it was 4 or 3.8. Well, regardless, we saw activity strike in Egypt today. So when we take a look at this overall, we really see a 4.3 struck in Albania. Then a 4.0 to 4.2 struck in central Italy, which was downgraded to a 3.6 and multiple 3.4s. Then a 4.2 struck along the plate boundary in Algeria. So Albania, Italy, Algeria, all three struck today by similar-sized earthquakes. And again, whether or not we go up or down in this ultimate magnitude is up to them. But that's the expected movement that we were expecting to strike today overall. When we just take a look at the activity, we'll turn this back down for the smaller earthquakes. And you'll be able to see the swarm basically got cut in half from where we were yesterday. That's good news somewhat, because as we told you yesterday, when you could go to sleep and sleep well throughout the night, and today the most we would see would be a 4.3 equal to the 4.3 to the east. And that did happen, and they ultimately downgraded it, whatever. But I think the proof is in the pudding that it was a 4.0 range earthquake, because then Algeria was struck. And we'll go ahead and open up a display capture so you can just see where Algeria resides on the edge of this African plate. And these are the plate boundary lines that I've shown in so many other videos, the red line that goes up into Italy. Okay, well, guys, again, Albania was struck right where the plate boundaries meet, coming up out of Greece and going into Italy right there in the Gulf of Taranto. Then look at the plate boundary to the west. The earthquake is where the star is, right along the plate boundary going out to the west. And it's not going to stop there. It's going to carry on out to the west, and we'll see over the next 1 to 2 days more earthquake activity develop out at the Mid-Atlantic Ridge as a result of this. So, ultimately, in Italy right now, of course, you're seeing a drag out or a gradual swell down of pressure. So, the pressure has spread out. We saw, again, the 5.5 that struck up in Poland that didn't make the earthquake feeds. We showed that on the live stream. Then you saw the near 3.0 strike in North Germany at the Holland border yesterday. Then we saw the earthquake activity spread out in Spain and Portugal and down to Algeria. So that means pressure is transferring out from central Italy. That's good news. It means the chance of that particular location swarming out as terribly as it has before is starting to reduce. Now, I told you yesterday that by tonight I'd be reporting on new earthquakes in the Mideast, right? It had gone silent, right? Go back and watch last night's update. The whole area across here had gone silent. I talked about Nepal, I talked about Afghanistan and Pakistan, and I talked about how the 5.1 would transfer across and go over to these regions and strike in the Mideast by tonight. Well, that's exactly what's occurred, and it lost about a half magnitude to a full magnitude's momentum going across this area. So here we are with a series of fours striking across the Mideast, again, Afghanistan and Pakistan, going up into Western China. Well, what does that mean? Well, I told you last night that 48 to 72 hours from now, we'd have a new incoming round of pressure coming into Italy that you could breathe easy last night, get a good night's sleep, have a good day today with the topping out at the 4.3. Not a big deal, not enough to knock down houses or anything. Now we see a new round of fours building back here, which means by tomorrow, we'll see an increase in pressure in South Europe. Now it all hinges over the next 24 hours for Italy. What's going to happen here in the Mideast? Are we going to see additional fives? If we start to see fives back here or greater, then we're looking at a real problem for Italy again in the next 2 days or less. So once this area swarms out, we only have 24 to 48 hours before it reaches, or I would dare say just 24 hours. But, you know, I want to give it a little time, but not long from the time that it takes to transfer from the Mideast over to Turkey and Greece. So let's get the earthquakes that happened yesterday off the map and pretty much only look at what we have from the EMSC right now. Now guys, there's another event that happened in here that's not shown on this feed. Right in the middle of all this, in North Sicily, there was a deeper earthquake. I think it was a 2.2 or a 2.3. Kind of a smaller earthquake, but a deep earthquake that happened at 120 kilometers or so down below North Sicily, right in the middle of all this. Well, there were two other deep earthquakes that happened today, one of which is still on the map here now, and that's the 2.6 that you see in eastern Romania. That's also at about 120 kilometers deep. It's kind of hard to see it raised off the globe here. Well, guys, deep earthquakes mean shallower, larger earthquakes, 1 to 2 magnitudes larger. Well, one magnitude larger than the 2.6 is a 3.6, obviously, and two magnitudes larger is a 4.6. So, with the fours forming over here and new deep earthquakes that translate up pressure within 48 hours as well, we're going to have a double whammy where we have fours coming in from the east, and you hope this stays at fours. Hope it stays at fours. If it goes up into fives over here to the east across Iran or Afghanistan, okay, that means increased pressure by a full magnitude back in South Europe. And the same locations will get hit because this area has not been allowed to settle out and for the faults to finally compress. You got to imagine that this whole area has been under serious pressure for the last, well, I mean, really, you could go back to August. But for the last 2 weeks, it's been in constant flux, moving up and down. 70 centimeters moving up, 70 centimeters moving down. Did I just breakdance? I think I did. Well, 70 centimeters going up, 70 centimeters going down. And that's a huge amount of movement for us in America, or if you're on the non-metric system, that's 27.5 inches. That's 2.5 feet of rise and fall along the plate boundary there. And it hasn't been allowed to stop moving yet. Every time it tries to settle down, a new round of pressure comes in and it kicks it up again. So right now, on your doorstep, over to the east, not on Italy's doorstep, on Europe's doorstep, over to the east, we're seeing the expected magnitudes that I would look for, 4 to 5, to strike here, right in the middle, between the two points that have already moved. We talked about this last night. Now we got over to the east because of a small earthquake that was in Turkey. But if we were to take that small earthquake that was in Turkey off the map and compute it from South Greece, where the huge swarm is, or Greece going into Italy, this is the halfway point between the 5.1 that you see down here and the earthquakes over in Europe. It's almost the exact half point. And that's the spot that was struck? I mean, come on. So, again, next 24 hours, we have to watch in the Mideast. This includes down east of Saudi Arabia. This includes Iran, South Russia, Turkey, against South Russia into Georgia between the Caspian Sea and the Black Sea. This is a very large area we have to watch for 4 to 5.0 earthquake activity. We're not really worried about those 4 and 5s causing major damage in this region. We're worried about that cumulative total of the 4s and 5s over a day's period that will add up and immediately press to the west. And when it presses to the west, of course, it gets back down into South Europe and we get to our plate boundaries again, which I will show you one more time. And pressure coming in from over here, follow the red line, and it comes right into South Italy. It transfers every single time. And if this area is not allowed to settle out, it will continue to move. It's basic logic, right? An area will continue to move if you put more pressure on it, and it'll continue to do that for the foreseeable future as we look at these earthquakes out over here in the West Pacific, which is the next area I'd like to quickly talk about. Now, we talked about Japan last night. Japan has not been hit in, how many days is this now? Is this 5 days? Yeah, in 5 days. Going on 6. But not hit according to who? It's a good question, right? Well, according to the feeds, right? Well, if you go over and check the Japanese feed, you'll see a 4.3 that occurred today down here next to Sakurajima Volcano. Now, guys, what are the chances? I just brought up Sakurajima Volcano last night on the live stream and showed it to everybody, provided the link to everybody, and talked about how it had seen a dramatic decrease in volcanic activity. Now we find out, and again, this is being hidden from us, that a 4.3 strikes right next to the volcano. What's that a sign of? That's a sign of possible building pressure below the volcano, of course. And it could lead to either a shallow or larger earthquake in the area. But take a look at where this resides in the middle point. I mean, I'm looking at central Japan, and southeast Japan gets this new earthquake that's hidden from everyone. Why? Well, look, it's right along the halfway point. If you really take the new earthquake that struck today or last night down in Philippines into account, I was measuring from further south. But another earthquake struck to the north, 4.7. Well, then that led to the silent zone moving just to the south by a little bit, right to where the 4 hit. And I would have been on tonight showing you that 4, but you have to go over to the Japan Meteorological Agency, the JMA, to even see it. You know what? Let's do that here. Let's go to the JMA. JMA earthquake. Okay, and we'll just go down. Here we go. Top list. And let's see the earthquakes. Here we go. Okay, so they got a 3.0 there right now, which you would expect them not to show that on international feeds. But here's our 4.3 that I was just telling you about. And look at the location again. Right offshore next to Sakurajima, which is in the inlet or the bay there. Now, come on, it's in Kyushu. And we're not getting a 4 reported to us by our own agencies. I'm not going to, you know, chastise the EMSC. They're doing their best. But the U.S. government, who's financing the USGS by the tune of, well, tens of hundreds of millions of dollars at some point, that they could provide that data to us. They're not. So anyways, you have to imagine a ring showing a 4.0 here. Okay, and if you did, you would see that's pretty much the halfway point between the two zones that moved. But it's only a 4.3. But it's right next to Sakurajima Volcano that I showed you guys last night that hasn't erupted in several months' time. And it used to erupt. I told you guys, I have a video on my channel of it erupting 83 times in one day. Big blast, not small, like 15,000-foot ash clouds, 83 times in one day. And when I posted that video, by the way, a bunch of people who were trying to downplay it, I don't know who they were, you know, what we call shills or trolls on the internet, came over to deny that it was a big deal that 83 eruptions happened in one day. And they said, this volcano erupts all the time. It's not that big of a deal. It erupts every day. Well, here we are. It hasn't erupted in months. What's going on? It's blocked. There's deformation happening on the side of the volcano. And warnings were issued, I guess, a month ago for the area around, telling them to watch out for a potential large catastrophic blast. And Kagoshima, the nearest large town with a couple hundred thousand people living in it, would of course be just inundated with ash if that happened. So, that being said, that brings us into the volcanoes of the Pacific. Hawaii, look at the screen, guys. Noteworthy earthquake swarm breaking out all the way across the entire island, Big Island, of Hawaii. Mainly centered around Kilauea and Pu'u'o'o. Did I say that right? Pu'u'o'o. Okay, so let's go take a look. Let's go see what's going on. This is the way you do it, guys. Go over to the Hawaiian Volcano Observatory, hvo.gov. I'll click it on here. It's hvo.wr.usgs.gov. Sorry. And then you'll find the CAM page. Then you click on these top links here, and it'll show you a panorama of all the webcams as they're streaming live. And the lava lake at Kilauea is going right across the top. It's literally within, I'd say, 20 feet of the actual rim again. The lava lake there is rising, increased pressure, but no eruption. Now, let's go to Pu'u'o'o, which is the more active of the two, the one that keeps splitting open on the side whenever too much pressure comes in. This guy keeps blowing open on the side, and right now, here, let me show you. This is a shot from October 31st, so it hasn't updated in a few days, but the lava flow from the last time that this thing ripped open, like 3 months ago, a huge amount of earthquake struck, increased pressure came in, the lava lake rose, then Pu'u'o'o volcano ruptured, a new fissure formed, and 3 miles of lava flowed out down towards the ocean. Well, is that getting ready to occur now? I mean, it's a good question. Now that's lava, that's actually, you see the steam off in the distance here. This is actually part of that lava flow that's hitting the ocean right now from the one that happened two or three, I don't know how long ago it was, several months ago. Okay, so it's getting ready to happen again, it looks like, unless this swarm dies out. But with this many threes going all the way across the island, it means the magma chamber down below is experiencing compression, pressure coming up from down below, and we shouldn't be shocked by that because what happened just a couple days ago? The deep earthquakes, of course. Deep earthquakes have now fanned out across the area, and this is why Japan is still under a watch, even in light of the 4.0, which I'll get into next. Now that you know a 4.0 struck in the middle point, this has halved our watch zones. Now instead of one watch zone to watch in the middle of, we have two watch zones to watch in the middle of. Both will be hit. So imagine the 4.3, or just call it a 4.5, right here in the middle at Kyushu. Then we look to the north halfway between the 5.4 up to the north and Kyushu. What's the halfway point between those two zones? Well, guys, halfway point puts us right off the coast of Hokkaido, going right into the South Kuril Islands. Very small little area right here in North Japan. Okay, so actually that's just Hokkaido. So middle point, let me turn down the rings here. Middle point between those two zones, again, North Hokkaido, somewhere right here along the coast. It's going to be a combination between the 5.4 and the 4.3 to the south, which takes us to 5.443, by the way. So we just watch for another 5.4 or similar two to strike North Japan very soon. Another earthquake just struck in Hawaii. Okay, so again, that's our halfway point to the north. Well, the halfway point to the south goes from Kyushu down all the way through Taiwan, and goes down to the 4.7 down here in South Philippines, I suppose that is, going into eastern Malaysia, northern Indonesia, and the halfway point between there and Kyushu takes us off the coast of South Taiwan, North Philippines. It'll be a combination of the 4.3 to the north and the 4.7 to the south, which basically puts us right at a 5. To be striking right along the coast or right off the coast of Southeast Taiwan, north of the northern island of Philippines. So very small stretch here. Both spots should get hit by those expected magnitudes in the next 2 days, 48 hours. It'll only take about 2 days or less for this pressure to transfer out, I'm assuming, because Japan has not been struck yet, with the larger of the earthquakes. The middle point has been struck. The other thing we have to watch out for, as if that wasn't all enough, is Sakurajima volcano to kick back to life after months of silence. Okay? So, elsewhere, these deep earthquakes are translating out over to the East Pacific. We talked about the 6.4 last night. We talked about the fives. Okay, well, what struck since last night? One earthquake. One. Okay? I mean, you know, you go in, actually, three. Three earthquakes. Three threes, actually. And they're stair-stepped, shallow, moderately deep, and the most recent earthquake, extremely deep, or at least right down below the plate. What does that mean? Well, it means the 6.4 has sent pressure to the north and it can't find a way to escape. So the pressure is right now traveling down below the plate, heading north in a direction that it really shouldn't head. It's bottlenecking at this point. This means a series of larger earthquakes is getting ready to develop out here at the midway point, South Peru, North Chile. And when I say larger, we're going to look at least two magnitudes larger than the 3.3 that's on the map for today. So, by tomorrow, we'll probably be reporting on a 5.3 or series of fives that struck back here at the central point. What'll happen here is it'll pool up, since the 6.4 a day and a half ago sent pressure to the north, it's now pooling up to the north and it has nowhere to go. It can't go over the plate and it can't go up the plate very much further. So it's going to try and go down underneath the plate, and then it's going to be reflected back due to the pressure that's overall coming across from the Pacific. And when that's reflected back, we're going to see this larger bit of earthquake activity take place at our central point yet once again. So we're not out of the woods yet in South America. Ultimately, it's going to press down here to the South Sandwich Islands, and man, I can't wait till it hits, because when it does, it's going to be big. And I'm not excited about that, you know, when I say I can't wait, but it's going to hit. And it's going to be bigger. There's nobody who really lives down here. And there's no potential for a large wave even. So we're talking about maybe an upper 6 to going into 7 now, depending on how much longer we have to wait. But the 6.4 already struck here. And like I said, it's sending pressure to the north, not to the south yet. It may happen very quickly, too. We might see a back-to-back happen within a few hours of each other once the pressure back fills up to the north crack here, the north bend at Peru and Chile, then it's going to go back down to the east, southeast. Here, hold on one second, guys. Let me get a sip of my earthquake juice. And we need to smear something on the wall, too. Okay, so that being said, guys, well, the earthquakes are going to strike down here to the east, southeast, and that's going to, again, happen over the next few days. It's already gone a day beyond what I'm looking for. So we're going one day now beyond the 72-hour watch I issued for. I issued a three-day watch for this. And it still hasn't hit. So, I mean, it's not that nothing's going to happen. Wait, is that a double negative? It's not that nothing's not going to happen. It's that it just hasn't happened yet. It's taking a little bit longer than normal, which means that there's going to be an increase in pressure when it finally does hit, including up this earthquake that strikes up here at the central point. That's going to play into that activity down here because it's going to spring back down to the south. There's overall movement that happens around the Pacific that goes from west to east. Sometimes it's northwest to east. So kind of like a clockwise, but I don't want you to get too much of a clockwise pattern worked into your head here, but just imagine it going west to east, and that kind of pushes the plate to the east, southeast as well. That's why the United States moves to the east by southeast. Because technically, if we really wanted to look at it, the earthquakes are progressing in a clockwise pattern, or at least west to east across the plate pattern across the Pacific. But off the west, another way you know that the plate is moving in a clockwise pattern, that coming off the edge of the plate, the Pacific plate, to the west, it pushes to the west, northwest. So you can imagine this like a pinwheel spinning around and the edges of the pinwheel catching on the other plates and kind of pushing the other plates to the west, northwest, as this plate kind of moves in its own place back and forth. It doesn't have anywhere to go, but it kind of jostles in place in a clockwise direction. So, that all being said, let's get into the United States, guys. What's happened today? Well, first of all, let's look at this last 7 days of earthquakes in the U.S. Do you notice anything? How about that 4 on the West Coast? Are they downgraded to 3.8? If you could see it, they downgraded it, so you can't see it. But if you could see it, you'd see another large ring like what looks in the Midwest. The 4 that struck in the Midwest. Why did a 4 strike in the Midwest? Why did a series of 4 strike in the Midwest? Now 3.8s. Well, a 3.8 struck on the West Coast. 3.8 struck on the West Coast, followed by a 3.8 in the Midwest. But really, this was a 4. And this was a 4. Go look them up. Don't have to take my word for it. It's on the magnitude origin charts. So, they downgraded. That's fine. But they downgraded both earthquakes, which matches perfectly. All right? Now, the reason this happened is because pressure builds on the West Coast, just like it does in Central America and South America. Pressure comes across from the West Pacific. And the West Coast of the U.S. in particular gets pretty much the leftovers off Japan and Alaska. Usually, when you look at the lateral fracture zones, the east to west fracture zones that come off the West Coast along the Gorda Escarpment, going down south, there's several more. Well, if you follow them west, they go across Hawaii and then meet up here and go up to Japan. So, our main player, let me give you a perfect example of this. Back in 2011, when the 9.0 megaquake hit in Japan, and we saw huge swarms of earthquakes develop out across Japan going up into the Aleutian Island chain. That was followed by heavy movement over 6 months' time to almost a year. Going into 2012, there was multiple large earthquakes off the coast of the northwest portion of California and the Washington state, including a 7.7 in 2012 that struck right here. 7.7 in 2012. 6.0s. A 7 striking in Napa. You remember this, guys? They downgraded it to like 6.4. Northern California, 2012. 7s on the West Coast. That followed the 9s, the 9 and the 8s and the 7s over here in Japan that were aftershocks and followed all the way across the plate. Now, if that 9 in Japan had struck more down here in, let's say, Sumatra, like that megaquake that happened in 2012, there were two near 9s that struck western Sumatra along the Indo-Australian plate, there was hardly any activity that spread over to the United States off that. Instead, guess what happened? Major movement occurred throughout Nepal after that, also over into Turkey with the megaquake that happened. You remember the large Turkish earthquake? Then the 6.8 struck near Moscow, and a 6.8 in Bartar Bunga happened. All that after we saw our movement along the Indo-Australian plate to the west. So, pressure transfers to the west, and this whole thing goes clockwise. So that's what plays into the United States. And if you're on the West Coast, you need to look internationally to see what's coming your way. So right now, the pressure has struck on the West Coast. It went all the way down the coast, and I'm going to show you these earthquakes now. Look at today's earthquakes, and we'll compare them to what struck, for instance, yesterday. The swarm in Northern California yesterday was off the map. Now it's not. Why? Well, pressure has transferred outwards. It's gone all the way over to the East Coast, quite frankly. But mainly, take a look at the earthquakes that struck. It went to the east by southeast and spread all the way over to Utah. Now get this, guys. South Nevada, the nuclear operations are moving again. This is a spot where humans have detonated underground nuclear explosives. And I'm going to go ahead and show you this so that you can just get a better idea of what I'm talking about. But every time this section moves, it lets us know two things are coming. Earthquakes in Southern California, and earthquakes off the coast of the northwest portion of California. These operations move when the volcanoes are moving, but usually these operations move before activity strikes off the coast of the northwest. That's the main player in this. Where do you see this? Let me just go ahead and select all. We'll paste in our coordinates. Again, these are small earthquakes, so we don't have anything to be alarmed about, but it's the U.S. underground nuclear test operations. They aren't doing nuke tests here right now. This is actually fractures in the crust from all these different craters where they blasted nukes. And there's so many of them, guys. Really, let me just go ahead and take, you know, I'm not a big environmentalist or anything, but the Google Earth community has done a pretty good job of marking the craters and what the military names were for each one. So these are the different names like Deck and Supper and Trogon. I mean, just each one, you guys are a Fisher, Damien 1, Pampas, okay, or Damani 1, and all of these craters are underground nukes. Plus, they did above-ground nuclear testing here back in the 50s when they built that town, that famous town that they blew away. You guys have all seen it in the movies where they have the mannequins and the houses. Okay, well, this is the same spot, so, or one of the spots. And it's struck by earthquakes, usually before pressure strikes along the coast. So right now, the 4 that struck a couple days ago has pressed all the way to the east. It's already reached the East Coast, guys. Now, I haven't checked the Canadian site today, so I don't know if they have anything listed up in Canada for today. But I think at this point, we probably should go look it up. Let's go check out NR Canada, because USGS doesn't show us earthquakes on the East Coast. And they didn't show us the earthquake in Maine yesterday, guys. Here we go. Yep, it's still there. Still there from yesterday. That's the last earthquake listed. A 2.0 in Maine. Now, that's listed in New Brunswick, but guys, the earthquake struck in Maine. USGS did not show us. Let's go ahead and open this up here. Let's get a copy of Google Earth, and we'll show you where it fell in Maine. Now, we would expect the USGS to report these things to us. If they don't, there's got to be some technical reason or some political reason they're not showing it to us. What is this? What is this mount? Porcupine Mountain. What else do we have here? Whitney Cove Mountain. Pineo Mountain. Okay, well, I'm not seeing anything of any significance nearby that would make it worth hiding, other than the fact that it's a 2.0 striking in Maine, in the spot where we warned, in the time where we warned, with the expected magnitude that we warned. And I told you guys, the earthquake pressure transfers out from the Midwest and goes over to the East Coast, and it strikes up to the Northeast, and we talked about the area of Southeast Quebec, and I specifically mentioned Maine this time, and Maine has now been, the spot to be struck by two. And there's a 2.1 down here on the eastern edge of the craton, lost a little bit of momentum going up the plate just by 0.1 and reduced it down to a 2, striking up here along the eastern edge of the craton before it goes out to the mid-Atlantic Ocean. Now, guys, as I'm talking here, a 3.6 has struck at the fracking operations in Oklahoma. I guarantee you this is actually a powerful enough earthquake to be felt by many of my viewers who are watching in Oklahoma. You probably just felt, if you live in central Oklahoma, a fairly nice shake. Since it's so shallow, it's at 5 km. Let's go ahead and put the coordinates in and just show everybody what's at the earthquake epicenter. By the way, I can hear my cat meowing upstairs in a room that's so far away you shouldn't be able to hear her. She is freaking out right now. She gets sensitive when there's earthquakes in the Midwest. So here we are right next to a dirty old rusted frack well. And it looks like they're putting a new pond there and a new pad, which means they probably got ready to relay it. When was this imagery taken? 2015. They could very well have. I wonder if we've got a street level on here. I know it's a dirt road in Kansas, but let's just hope. Nope. No street level view. All right. Well, that's just one example of many frack wells that are nearby. We can zoom it back out, see all these different pads down to the south. I don't have any of these marked. I probably should. Here's a compressor station with a frack well. This is a pipeline compressor station where they take the combined total of all the wells nearby, condense the gas, and then put it along in a pipeline, pump it off for processing and sale on the market. So we just go down the road. Every single one of these is a different pumping operation. Each one they've drilled down into the crust, sometimes by several thousand feet. And just like you can imagine drilling into a rock or anything, if you apply pressure on a drilled rock, it's going to fracture along that drill point. Like a break in a concrete. You guys know when you lay concrete and you put a concrete break in there and the crack in the concrete follows the break? Okay, well, the same thing occurs when humans create a break, and we've created a huge break with all the different pumping operations. Like I said, every single white pad that you see is a different pumping operation. You can just zoom in on any one of them and find out for yourself. It's tragedy, okay? I got tired of marking them. That's how many different pumping operations there are. Let me turn on my place marks so you can see those. And let me hit search again for the earthquake. So I've spent years, and I mean like 7 years, researching this topic. We pushed it to the forefront, fracking earthquakes. We were fought tooth and nail by everybody in the industry and even people on YouTube. And so earthquake 3.6, noteworthy striking there, but I don't think anybody should be shocked. Why? Again, just a day and a half ago, we saw 3.8 on the West Coast. Earthquakes are progressing across the plate. I think it's pretty much a sign that pressure is there, building again off the coast, and it's going to be, well, larger than the last one to strike. The last one was a 4, basically. They've downgraded it to 3.8. The next round is going to be a step higher, so that's going to take us into upper 4.8 to 5. And that will then increase things across the entire continent of the United States. Now, Southern California, Los Angeles, you guys are also on watch. Let's go ahead and turn on. Let's make sure this is the last 24-hour feed. and show the last 24 hours. Now, Southern California, you're swarming out in two different locations with a new silent spot that's developed out. Okay, the swarms have kind of died out, by the way, letting you know it's transferring back to the northwest. But Santa Barbara coast. Coast to Santa Barbara, combined total between all these ones, and well, I guess they're all just ones. Ones down to the south and a few twos to the north puts us at like a 2.5. Not a big deal, but it just completes the forecast. It lets us know Southern California's moved. Actually, you know what? Scratch that. We need to actually take it up by one more because there was a 2.5 that struck yesterday that we still have to take into account for 48 hours. Forgot about that. So take it up by one notch, 3.5. It's coast of Santa Barbara. All right. So I know yesterday we talked about Los Angeles. Now it's coast of Santa Barbara. It's about 5 miles, 10 miles difference from where we were looking, from basically Santa Barbara down to Ventura. Okay. So keep watch there. And up to the north. Where up to the north? Well, this time we're looking off the coast. Last time we were looking on the coast, and it did. It struck right south of Eureka on land. This time we're looking off the coast at the cleft segment going south to the Gordo Escarpment yet once again. Cleft segment is at the triangular bend here, and Gordo Escarpment is the east to west fracture zone. You see a large line going across the screen there. Okay, well, right offshore, it's just a small area to watch, and that's going to be the spot. Now we're going to put a 72-hour watch on this, 3 days, and in 3 days' time, we should have seen this pressure transfer all the way across. Hawaii's a telltale giveaway that the pressure's already coming across now. Central portion of the plate. Now down to the south, more proof that pressure is coming across the central portion of the plate. The south mid-Pacific rise north of Antarctica moved. So the mid-Pacific is in flux. The only area to the north hasn't moved yet, and that's up in Alaska. The last 24 hours, take a look at it, guys. No earthquake activity up in Alaska. Central portion in Alaska near Mount Atka, right here, this long island, is our fulcrum point to the north. Kamchatka moving volcanically at Kluchevskoy and Shevulek volcanoes here at Kamchatka. Then over to the east, we have no earthquake activity going all the way down to the coast of the United States. Halfway point, Mount Atka in between these two zones. So watch the Aleutian Island chain going into, well, let's put a 48-hour watch on that, and it's going to be similar in size to the fives that have struck over the past day down to the south. It's going to compensate to the north. So it's not just going to be Japan. I don't want everybody to just think we're focusing only on Japan, but take a look at it. Last 48 hours, okay, the activity, small activity in Alaska. So again, those fives creeping around the coast or around the whole plate will pick up back in Alaska. Nobody should be shocked by that, and I don't even think anybody lives there. Okay? What else is going on? I'm hearing a lot of earthquakes ding off as I'm talking. Looks like the swarm over in Italy is starting to, what? Have a couple more? Just had a 3.8? 3.8? There you go! Is that right? Did that just hit? Yeah! 3.8 just hit. Let's go check the station location information on this. Oh boy, oh boy. All right, let's go to four seismologists. See what we got. Okay, here it is. They've got it at 3.8 to 4.1. Listen to the station list here. 4.1, 4.5, 4.3, 4.4, 3.9, 4.3, 4.4, 4.5, 4.4, 4.2. There's the 4.3. Oh, look, one station picked up 6.8. Fives. Apparently, it was pretty heavy shaking, guys. Apparently, that one was pretty heavy shaking that just occurred. That's coming from Geophone, German. INGV has it at 3.8. Let's go see what their station information is. Okay, 3.8, 4.0, 4.1, 4.0, 4.1, 3.9, 3.7. These lower it. 4.1, 4.1, 4.4, 4.2. This is going to take it to about a 4.3. So there you go. There it is. They're going to... Oh, it's in Macerata. That's where Janet is. That's where Janet is, guys. Janet Fuller Love's right there. All right, well, guys, a near four struck. I mean, definitely they've got it. The INGV has it at 3.8. but the station list is showing anywhere between 4 and 4.5. I would dare say it goes to 4.3. That's the exact magnitude we were looking for to strike by tonight. So regardless of whatever struck earlier that they downgraded and swarmed out, there's the 4.3 right there. So they removed the other one. That's fine. They downgraded the other one to 3.5. Now another one struck. So, and that, again, that follows the 2.6. The deep 2.6 led to the shallow 3.6 to 4.6. There it is. Oh, my God. Wow. Okay, I mean, there it is. So it struck. It just struck in the time that the forecast was going. Guys, the deep earthquake just caused our shallower, larger earthquake nearby in the swarm zone, as we were expecting. What did I tell you? Deep 2.6 leads to shallow 3.6 to 4.6. Okay? And now the 4.6 is struck. They downgraded it to 3.8. Station list showing anywhere between 4 and 5. They're going to have to upgrade it. I don't see how they could just go with the 3.8. They're going to have to throw out those lower readings. Too many stations reporting above 4. I don't know. They might, again, politics plays into this, guys. You saw the station list for yourself. You can make your own determination and averages if you believe that you're going to go with the low ball on that. We'll have to talk to the people in the area. How much shaking did they feel? Was it kind of intense? Was it like a 4? Or was it just a little bit of shaking? Was it a 3? You know what I mean? Well, there it is. So regardless, like I said, 2.6 leads to 3.6 to 4.6. Well, they've got it at, you know, a 3.8, so that falls within the realm of acceptability. And the turnaround time on that was what, 12 hours, guys? So 12 hours from the time the deep earthquake struck in Romania and down in Turkey, and the shallow earthquake in Italy. There we go. So, all right, now we're watching for that new round of pressure to come in. The good news is those two deep earthquakes kind of just expended that pressure from the deep earthquake, so the double whammy probably won't happen. But, you know, I was talking about the deep earthquakes and these earthquakes both coming in within the next, you know, well, I said by tomorrow night, right? I said tomorrow night it would be there. So here we go. These fours are going to be in there by tomorrow night. And those deep earthquakes just caused that movement back in central Italy. Glad we got the warning out on those deep earthquakes in time. I don't know if anybody listened, but there it is. So I'm kind of blathering on at this point. Just understand we're watching for new movement to strike on the West Coast. That'll go upwards of 5. Once that 5 strikes on the West Coast, watch for a new swarm back at the fracking operations, Kansas, Oklahoma. You cannot escape. You are the final stop-off point in the Midwest for that pressure as it transfers across the edge of the plate. So just be aware, that's what you got to look forward to. Central America, South America, like I told you, we already know where to watch in South America. I didn't really touch on Central America. South Mexico at Guatemala, the warning issued, what did we do, 2 days ago? 2 days ago, I issued a warning for South Mexico at Guatemala, or was it 3 days ago? It was 3 days ago, I'm sorry. 72 hours ago, I issued a warning for the border of Mexico at Guatemala and put a 72-hour watch on it. Now look, in the past 2 days, what's the only area to get struck? Okay, that's the only spot to get struck. Then, a day ago, we issued a warning for the Gulf of California. Gulf of California has not been hit yet. And we issued, I think it was a 48-hour watch on that. So today is, what, the end of day one, start of day two? Or end of day two, start of day three? So, depending on which way you look at it, which time zone you're in. But we're going to have to, again, watch today for that movement in Gulf of California. And like I said, it could go to 5. Why? Because of the volcanoes. So the area we warned 3 days ago with a 3-day watch got hit on day 3. So we may have to, again, just watch one more day down here in the Gulf of California for that final follow-up movement to strike. Again, that's coming off of last week's movement. So South America, you know where to watch. Central America, you know where to watch. To the south of Central America, I guess North South America or South Central America, it's kind of weird to say, we're going to have to watch south of the volcanoes that are moving. Well, up in Costa Rica, we have the activity striking, but Turrialba is the only volcano there erupting, putting our area in between these two spots into Panama, and it should see a similar sized earthquake to what struck here. So we'll watch for the 5 to the north up in Gulf of California, and we'll watch for a similar size mid 4 to strike in Central America. Again, that's not that big of a deal for people. So if you're in Italy, by tomorrow I should be reporting on new earthquakes across the Mideast, like we were talking about today, pressing over into Europe, and that will re-increase you. And by Monday night, we should be talking about either have your plan dusted off, or by Monday night I'll be reporting on an earthquake striking, one of the two. A larger earthquake, not a huge earthquake. We would only see a larger earthquake in Italy. Hey, listen up. We would only see a larger earthquake in Italy right now if a few things occur. Either a swarm of fives or larger would have to hit the Mideast from Saudi Arabia up to Afghanistan and Iran, or a huge swarm of earthquakes would have to break out in Turkey and Greece. That's what would lead to a new earthquake of noteworthy size in Italy right now. Right now, we're just playing around with these deep earthquakes and the incoming pressure. But if the incoming pressure increases, gets larger, that's when you have to watch out for the larger earthquake. It's simple physics. If you increase the pressure, you have to watch for a larger break, right? Okay, so it's just a matter of people didn't know up until recently, until we found it out actually, that the plate is moving in the opposite direction across thousands of miles. It's moving from east to west, all the way out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. It's amazing. So, have a plan. Be prepared. Don't be scared. I want you guys first to know what's going on. Secondly, I don't want you guys to panic. So we're not looking for a super large earthquake yet back in Italy based upon what's going on, but it's going to pick up in size. We'll increase our magnitudes most likely by one-fold at least. So we'll go up from threes back into fours, for instance, depending on what happens by tomorrow. So keep watch. But you're dying out right now. The largest you're going to top out at, again, like I said, would be in that 4.6 range, which is not enough to knock down houses, thank God. It's enough to shake. It's enough to wake you up and scare you, but it's not enough to cause church bell towers to collapse and, you know, churches, basilicas to fall over. That won't happen off these size earthquakes. So, whew, right? That's good news. But in the long run, we have to watch over the next few days for new pressure to come in. And I will warn you, I will be here, but you already see it. 4.2 already here. All it's going to take is a few more of those, and you're going to see fours return back into Italy. 4.2 in the Mideast equals four in Italy within a couple days' time. 5.2 in the Mideast equals five, or a large swarm equal to a five, in Italy within a few days' time. Multiple fives in the Mideast equals a six, or a swarm of fours and near fives in central Italy. As this goes up, this goes up. Make sense? Okay. Much love, everybody. Much love. Tanto amore. Grazie to everybody in the international live stream for those who are speaking Italia. And for all my viewers in the U.S., guys, thank you for tuning in. It looks like we got about 400 people in here right now. If you're not subscribed, please subscribe to my channel. Let me get a sip of my coffee here. Ooh. Oh, whoa. Woo. Again, I almost choked. Man, this is like one of these cups that keeps it super hot. Whew. Man, on fire. All right. So, guys, thank you for being part of sharing my information and getting it out. I rely on my viewers to get the warnings out. We got the warnings out to people in Italy last week when this all happened, and I'm positive that people's lives were either saved or serious injuries were prevented by you guys sharing the information. So, thank you. And I want to thank everybody who's again donated to my fundraiser, which I will refresh on the screen here right now. I have a public fundraiser. If you like my work, I'm supported by my viewers. And this is to get me through for the whole year, comparable to what I would make doing carpentry and tree cutting, which is what I do for a living, by the way. If you need arbor work done or carpentry done, I'm your guy. But yeah, or I can do an earthquake forecast for you. Which would you like? Much love to everybody. Thank you for giving to my operation. Again, the link is down below in the description box if you guys want to give and support what I do. Or you can send something to my P.O. box, which is cool because check this out, guys. Look what I got last, what I opened up yesterday or a day ago, this shirt says Mount Dutch Super Volcano, sent to me by a viewer in Idaho. Mount Dutch Super Volcano, how about that? And then I got sent some lotto tickets. They also, a person sent me an aquamarine for my wife, Jewel. I think that's aquamarine. Also got some hats and some sunglasses, all kinds of stuff. So you guys sent books that I've been reading and letters that I've been reading on the live stream. I want to thank you for doing that. It's been incredible just to get to know you guys. So if you have a question, if you guys have a question, you can write me in my P.O. box. You don't just have to send a gift. You can write me a question. I'd be happy to answer it on the live stream. So P.O. box is listed down below as well, right next to my fundraiser. All right. So peace out, guys. Peace out. Have a good evening, morning, afternoon, depending on where you are. End out the weekend good. We got some craziness going on here in the United States. Let me get a sip of my earthquake juice again. Yeah, that earthquake juice, you know. You just gotta, you know, I need something to smear on the wall. Anybody got something I can smear? What should I smear on my wall to make the earthquakes go away? I don't know. Anyways, it's getting crazy here, and that's what I'm here for. As the true voice in science that's presenting itself on YouTube and trying to fight the corruption in science and trying to get the word out in new breaking discoveries. We're the only ones that are here, guys. That's it. I mean, there is no other channel doing that, and I hope you enjoy the content. Please share it. Please feel confident to get the warnings out to your friends, family, loved ones, people you know over in Italy, people you know on the West Coast. Let them know on the West Coast right now. Let them know in Oklahoma right now. There's a guy who's issued a warning for Oklahoma to watch out for a new earthquake within 72 hours after we see movement on the West Coast. It'll be similar in size. So if we're looking for a 5 on the West Coast, we're looking for like a 4.5 in the Midwest. And that's enough to cause, like I said, damage inside your house, knock things off shelves. Not enough to destroy your house, but it's enough to knock things off shelves and scare you. So get the warning out now to the people in the Midwest. Get the warning out now to the people on the West Coast. Hey, you're going to see a 5 off the coast here in a minute. Don't worry. Not a big deal. It happens. It's going to push to the east and cause problems for the people in the Midwest. And it's going to push down to the south and cause problems at the pumping operations in Southern California. That's the result. It's not that big of a deal, but it is a big deal. It's not lethal, but it's definitely could save some people from physical harm, some kind of damage, something falling and hitting them, that kind of stuff. So you guys can do your part in getting the warning out. Thank you for doing that. Peace out. I'll be back if anything else goes down.